Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rewired, Protecting Your Brain in the Digital Age, by Carl D. Marci, M.D. Narrated by Mike Lenz. Introduction. The best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. Proverb. I remember it like it was yesterday. As CEO and chief science officer of the company, I did not always attend our field studies. But some senior executives were scheduled to visit the lab to watch our research live, so I took the Amtrak into Midtown Manhattan that morning to oversee the experience. There was closed-circuit video set up in multiple small living rooms so that we could view the first few participants. These young women were being paid $150 each to watch television for an hour, while their smartphone behaviors and eye movements were recorded for analysis by our team back in Boston. Half the women were asked to leave their phones in another room so that we could compare their behaviors with those of participants who were able to keep their phones. Immediately, I noticed something strange about the first participant in the group. She was visibly distressed without her smartphone, frowning, fidgeting, and squirming in her seat. She clutched the couch like she was about to jump out of her skin. At first, I thought she was just getting settled into the unfamiliar surroundings. Or maybe she was having an anxiety attack. But the odd behavior continued. I then wondered whether she was using drugs, which sometimes happened in our studies. But the staff did not notice any strange behaviors in the moments prior to the study. Her odd behavior was getting worse as time passed. I started to think she was going to leave early. After about 10 minutes, that is exactly what happened. She jumped up, ran out of the room, grabbed her smartphone and other belongings, and without payment or comment, she left the facility. She was not the only one. The fall of 2011 was early in the smartphone revolution. The research team at Turner Broadcasting was paying us for a custom neuroscience-informed study that would shed light on a new phenomenon, the simultaneous use of a second screen, smartphone or tablet computer, while watching live television, which media and advertising executives often called the first screen. We expected viewers would use their smartphone when it was available, significantly distracting them from watching the advertising on television, but viewers without smartphones would be more attentive to the TV ads. In fact, that's just what we found. But we did not expect some of the responses we saw from several participants deprived of their smartphones. We had enlisted women between the ages of 18 and 22. They were all heavy media multitaskers. They told our recruiters that they frequently watched conventional TV and used their smartphone at the same time. Each participant was randomly assigned to one of two groups. Women in the first group were asked to watch an hour of television with their phones available. They received simple instructions: use your smartphone like you would at home watching television. Those in the second group were asked to leave their smartphones and any other technology in a secure waiting area for the duration of the study. Of the thousands of research participants we have studied over the years, none surprised me like this. Healthy young people were in physical and emotional distress, apparently owing to smartphone deprivation. It was not just one person. The same odd behavior I witnessed in the first participant occurred in several others. Of the group that was allowed to keep their phones, no one left without finishing the one-hour study. They all calmly watched TV while periodically checking their phones, and then got paid. It made me wonder what might be happening. Could it be that these young women were going through a form of withdrawal caused by separation from their smartphones? It occurred to me that they were behaving like the rats placed in Skinner boxes for drug studies in the 1950s. Which I had watched on films as a pre-med and psychology undergraduate. B.F. Skinner was the father of behavioral theory. Part of his fame came from putting lab rats in a small box where they could press a lever to access sugar water or a drug such as cocaine or heroin. The lab rats quickly learned to choose the drug over the water and in time became addicted. Then Skinner would take access to the drug away from the rats and watch their behavior change. The deprived rats would fidget and squirm in their box, suggesting a level of agitation. This was an early insight into the behavioral signs of withdrawal that result when the addicted brain is deprived of drugs of abuse. Were these emerging smartphone habits also addicting? When I watched that young woman squirm, I came face to face with a new reality, one far scarier than our big media clients were interested in. Turner Broadcasting was very concerned about the ways in which this powerful mobile media technology was changing television consumption habits, and about the rapidity with which those changes were happening. But these concerns were primarily related to advertising revenue. I saw other problems. I have the privilege of being at the leading edge of media research. I saw people's habits changing in front of my eyes. And as a trained physician and psychiatrist who had studied the brain for years, it seemed to me that advertising revenue was not the most serious of our worries. Our world is changing. Fast. The way we work, the way we travel, the way we entertain ourselves, and importantly, the way we interact and communicate. In fact, the pace of change is so incredibly fast that it can be hard to understand what and just how much change has happened over the last decade. Our brains aren't wired to understand this level of complexity. We store and recall what's relevant to us here and now. Our ability to place things in a historical context and understand them is limited when change occurs at high speed. Our brains are imperfect information processors, yet we have become accustomed to thinking of our brains as computers. So powerful is this metaphor that we no longer cringe at the notion of being wired or of rewiring ourselves. But as computer processing speed, availability, and capacity increase, it appears that human brain processing speed, availability, and capacity may be decreasing. This has important consequences. This book is about those consequences. The modern media landscape raises important questions for children, adults, parents, caregivers, educators, politicians, and researchers. Understanding when to introduce what type of media experience to young children and how to set limits is of growing concern for all of us. Interactive programs, whether educational apps or casual games, are increasingly popular. Some are too complex or too new for academic researchers to assess beyond preliminary insights. This forces us to look back at prior research with old media as a guide to interpreting new research on the impact of new media. And with the lens of modern neuroscience, several concerning themes become clear. Our brains are constantly changing. Neural rewiring occurs from the day we are born to the day we die, albeit in different ways over the course of our lifespan. All experiences shape who we are and who we are becoming. Small experiences have a small impact on the brain. Large experiences have a large impact on the brain. Some experiences shape our brains for better, and some shape us for worse. Our experiences with mobile media, communications, and information technologies are no different. Screens are now ubiquitous in the classroom, in the workplace, and in every facet of our lives. The mobility and accessibility of screens foster small and large experiences every day, many times a day. These experiences rewire our brains as they create new habits, influence our mental and physical health, define who we are, or who we pretend to be, and affect how we relate to one another. The rewiring metaphor that is used throughout this book is not meant to imply that rewiring our brain is necessarily good or bad. It is meant to remind us that when we change our behaviors, we change our brains. Period. When we are blind to massive changes and more reactive than proactive when faced with the power of the supercomputer in our pocket, this rewiring can result in negative consequences. When the consequences related to global shifts in the use of these devices are ignored or minimized, they will contribute to unhealthy outcomes at all levels of a society increasingly dependent on the very same devices. These are some of the themes we will explore in this book. Part 1, Wired, Connecting Brains, sets the stage. I review some milestones in the history of media and advertising, which created the conditions for the rapid ascent of what we euphemistically call the smartphone. I then introduce some key concepts about the prefrontal cortex, the most sophisticated and intricate region of the human brain. The power of the prefrontal cortex is clear in both the evolutionary history of the species and across the lifespan of the organism, as individual humans develop from childhood through adulthood. The prefrontal cortex is the key to our humanity. It gives rise to executive function and plays a critical role in our relationships. Relationships that emerge because we are fundamentally wired to connect as social creatures. The prefrontal cortex is also the region of the brain most vulnerable to the impact of our changing media and technology behaviors. At the same time, the prefrontal cortex is our best defense against the many new sources of threat in the digital age. This powerful bit of brain protects us from succumbing to superstimuli and other tricks and attractions online, with their endless rewards and compulsion loops that are literally an arm's reach away. A healthy prefrontal cortex helps us interpret and manage the responses we receive from our more primitive reward and emotion centers. It is the key to forming relationships and to a healthy self-identity. The prefrontal cortex helps us achieve success at school and at work. Collectively, these capabilities make the prefrontal cortex an essential arbiter of impulse control. The prefrontal cortex guards us against poor decisions and thereby mitigates the impact of unhealthy behaviors that can lead to unhealthy habits and addictions. As we will hear, if the prefrontal cortex becomes even slightly compromised due to stress, neglect, fatigue, media multitasking, information overload, or succumbing to the superstimuli and disinformation that are ubiquitous online, we put ourselves at great risk. Our risk of forming unhealthy habits and ultimately addictions increases just as our ability to make healthy judgments and decisions for ourselves, our families, and our society decreases. This is the theme of Part 2, Rewired, Assaulted Brains. This section takes us through the many consequences of the rapid ascent of smartphones in our lives. I examine the impact of this changing world from the beginning of the lifespan, identifying major impacts of smartphone use on the prefrontal cortex from infancy onward, and exploring the repercussions on the growing brain and person. The goal is to create a framework for understanding new recommendations for parents and all people based on the best available science. Each life stage presents the brain with unique challenges. One of these challenges, the one presented to the young study participants at the Time Warner Media Lab in New York, is media multitasking. Almost all of us have embraced this new habit, but it has its dangers. I will describe research showing how multitasking tricks people of all ages into thinking we are being more productive. In fact, multitasking reduces speed and efficiency, so we accomplish less while potentially working harder. Turning exclusively to adults, I then explore the fine line between habits and addictions in the brain and discuss the consequences of ignoring our new habits, which can have a profound impact on our relationships, our mental health, and our physical well-being. But while our digital habits create hazards at every stage of life, we are not without opportunities to protect our brains. In Part 3, Beyond Wired, Better Brains, I guide listeners toward a comprehensive digital literacy, explaining how to identify digital age problems in ourselves, our coworkers, our friends, and our loved ones. Included are 10 empirically driven recommendations to help protect our brains in general and the prefrontal cortex in particular. Against the onslaught of the moment, we should keep in mind the meaningful solutions we can bring to bear. It won't do to just discard our digital lives. We can't, and there is a lot to like in these technologies. Smartphones and related tools offer portable powerhouses of information, communication, media, and commerce. They enable and encourage a constant connection to entertainment, news, work, education, friends, and family. They literally put the world at our fingertips while rarely leaving our side. The benefits are obvious and indisputable, and so are not really my focus. Instead, I want to take a sober look at the costs and negative consequences, as well as the opportunities we have to mitigate the downsides. The rapid adoption and unprecedented behavioral changes these technologies inspire explains the growing concern about the impact of these technologies, even as we continue to adapt to their ubiquitous presence. New habits, new forms of content, and new ways of engaging with mobile media, communications, and information technology are changing our children's developing and our adult brains in meaningful ways. As we explore the impact of smartphones and other technologies on the developing and ultimately the adult prefrontal cortex, my goal is not to cover every potential topic in a comprehensive manner. Rather, I aim to highlight research that speaks clearly to the benefits of digital literacy for everyone. Because of their extraordinary benefits, and despite the many challenges they create, smartphones are here to stay. We all need to work together to put up some stoplights and warning signs on what we once fondly called the information superhighway. And we need to learn how to use these rapidly evolving technologies in service of healthier versions of ourselves, while avoiding their detrimental consequences. As a society, we need to be more proactive than reactive in our approach to a changing world of mobile technology, with its constant connections, endless rewards, and very real consequences. COVID considerations. The COVID-19 pandemic altered nearly every aspect of our lives, even halting some activities critical to well-being. But beyond the staggering death tolls, economic strife, and disruptions in how we work, learn, and play, the impact on the mental health of children and adults created its own set of problems. Think about it. More time indoors, social isolation, remote work and school, the cessation of live entertainment, travel, and social gatherings from grade school to graduations. Many of us have spent a lot more time on screens since March 2020, a phenomenon with worldwide implications for mental and physical health. We have even developed names for new problems like Zoom fatigue and pandemic panic. We learned to sit all day on video conferences, constantly messaging exhausted and burned out colleagues on Teams, Slack, and WhatsApp. We've taken bathroom breaks, hoping we hit the right button to mute the sound and turn off the camera. And after peeling our tired and strained eyes off the screen at the end of the day and taking a short break for dinner, it's on to the Chromebook or the Seesaw app to help the kids with homework. After finally crawling into bed, we wonder if we ever got this tired before the pandemic. It is hard to remember. That is, if we have been lucky enough to have a job that allows us to work at home and the resources to educate our children remotely. Before the pandemic, we spent a lot of time online consuming media, communicating with each other, and playing games. New habits were formed, some of them bordering on addiction, all of them with consequences. Since the pandemic, things have only gotten worse. Shifts in complex human behaviors are always hard to understand, and researchers are just beginning to sift through the data. But if there were rising concerns before COVID-19, alarm bells should be ringing in the aftermath. The impact of the virus on our collective screen behaviors is easy to see, but hard to comprehend. When comparing time spent online accessing news and current events by U.S. adults in March 2019, before the pandemic, and March 2020 at its onset, we see a nearly threefold increase. Time spent streaming video hit an all-time high on Easter weekend 2020, as COVID-19 case counts increased and Americans looking for a distraction from the news sought out entertainment online. One global estimate finds that children spent twice as much time staring at screens in May 2020 as in May 2019. This COVID effect, as some have called it, sees more time spent on gaming, social media, and apps associated with schooling. The implications of a year and more of altered screen behavior around the world are potentially staggering. How staggering? As is a constant refrain in this book, correlation is not the same as causation. However, when we consider the shifting use of media, communications, and information technology during the pandemic, and as we see how the lives of so many adults and children have been interrupted, it is not surprising to hear statistics about a growing mental health crisis, whose consequences may linger longer than those of COVID-19. Research shows unprecedented levels of stress during the pandemic, and there have been calls for more mental health resources from almost every corner of society. UK government surveys show that 10% of British adults reported symptoms of depression between July 2019 and March 2020, compared to 19% in June 2020. And in the United States, the proportion of adults reporting symptoms of either anxiety or depression rose from 11% in June through December 2019 to 42% in December 2020. This book was written before the pandemic drove hundreds of millions of people around the world inside their homes in the name of social distancing, leading to still greater dependence on media, education, and productivity technologies. Even as the crisis resolves, its impact on screen time, media multitasking, and the behavioral changes associated with the digital age are likely here to stay. After all, when it comes to the influence of digital technologies in our lives, COVID reinforced trends long underway and has only made the problems investigated here more urgent. Part 1. Wired. Connected Brains. 1. Media Matters. Scanning the news online, a headline catches my attention. Man, distracted by electronic device, identified after falling to death at Sunset Cliffs. It is shocking and tragic. The authorities identified the victim as a 33-year-old Indiana man who was visiting friends in San Diego. Witnesses said he was not watching where he was going and was obviously looking down at the device in his hands. Distracted by a smartphone or similar handheld digital device, he lost his footing and fell 60 feet off the cliff ledge. He was pronounced dead at the scene. Authorities used the opportunity to remind citizens that we need to be mindful of our environment when using digital media devices, whether we're tempted to text while driving or enjoying a hike. This incident from 2015 is not the only case of digital distraction leading to death and other physical mishaps. That same year, two tourists slipped down the steps of the Taj Mahal while posing for a selfie. One died of head injuries, the other fractured his leg. Another man was so focused on taking a photo of himself during the annual running of the bulls in Spain that he failed to get out of the way of the animals and was gored to death. A woman fell off a pier into Lake Michigan while typing into her phone. Another woman fell into a water fountain inside a mall while walking and using her smartphone. Neither was seriously injured, but the fountain diver was mortified when the mall security team shared video of her fall on social media. You can hear the security guards laughing at her as they watched the video repeatedly at multiple angles. She is seen in a subsequent interview in tears as the video goes viral, amplifying her grief. Some of these, to be sure, are extreme examples, but they illustrate how serious the consequences of tech behavior can be. Many of our new media, communications, and information technology habits are resulting not only in more accidents from distractions, but also reduced productivity, disrupted relationships, increasing mental and physical health problems, and public safety issues that we need to take seriously and address as a society. In fact, many of the consequences of our new behaviors are so severe that experts are starting to describe them in the language of addiction. This suggests that the rewards from new applications of technology are so powerful that they are rewiring our brains to automatically respond to every app ping and message ring, no matter the risks that may be associated with that behavior in a particular context. Despite the many advantages of these technologies, there are signs that lots of people recognize the downsides. A study of consumers across 9 countries by the Ford Motor Company found that 78% of women think technology is contributing to sleep deprivation. and 63% of adults agree that technology is making them more impatient and less polite. The study also found that some 80% of adults think social media is more optics than substance. That is, people perceive online representations as commonly false or self-serving. The report calls this a tech spiral caused by continuous connectivity, changes in the way we communicate, and countless hours consuming a non-stop stream of entertainment, social media, advertising, information, and too often, disinformation. All the time. The Ford report concludes that in response to our changing technology world, there is now clear and undeniable evidence that we have a love-hate relationship with our mobile media, communications, and information devices. Technology continues to unfold at breakneck pace, but it's also prompting greater reflection on the impact on our lives, states Cheryl Connolly, Ford's corporate futurist, in the report's introduction. She cites the mounting number of people claiming that our increasing reliance on mobile gadgets has negatively affected society. We are getting more distracted, divided, and depressed. We are changing the nature of our social bonds and our brains. We are all less engaged in intimate ways with the people and experiences that we used to care about. Change comes at a price. Our collective tech-life balance needs adjustment as we wrestle as a society to define a new form of digital literacy. As we adopt modern mobile technologies and embrace their myriad benefits, we need to be cognizant of the growing consequences of how we adapt to their use. How can we begin to understand the drivers of these massive shifts in our behaviors as the modern smartphone rewires our brains and alters our lives? Before we look forward in an attempt to restore balance, we need to look backward and understand how we got here. Our changing world. In order to appreciate the massive shifts in our relationship with modern media technology today, we need to answer an important question. How did media come to dominate our lives? One compelling theory, offered by sociologist Todd Gitlin, suggests that in the early 20th century, as the gains of the Industrial Revolution were being realized, American workers and employers made an implicit bargain. On the one hand, workers could take advantage of increased productivity by working less and gaining leisure time. Many European countries went this route, choosing longer vacations over increased paychecks. On the other hand, workers could choose higher wages. Gitlin contends that American business leaders and laborers chose to pad their pocketbooks. With more money and new technologies enabling faster production, corporations realized they had an opportunity to boost profits. As it became relatively easy to generate new products while allowing older ones to descend into obsolescence, companies could repeatedly introduce improved goods and services. The challenge was to ensure that there was demand for them. To generate mass consumption, mass advertising was needed. Corporations rolled out a constant stream of messages that began to seep into and shape our collective imagination. As Gitlin notes, pictures of purchasable utopias proved pervasive. Even while protesting how many hours they worked, workers came to prefer the pursuit of happiness via commodities to the pursuit of leisure. What made these pictures of supposedly purchasable utopias ubiquitous was a new kind of media platform that provided the necessary channels for advertisements. In the early days, that platform comprised mainly ad-supported radio programs, newspapers, and magazines. By mid-century, television came along and reshaped our living rooms with easily accessible moving pictures of live news, sports, and entertainment. Early television programming, with paid sponsorships on just a few broadcast networks, generated enormous audiences and enormous profits for media companies and the firms that advertised with them. Over time, we radically changed our behaviors, consuming far more media than ever before and doing so in new ways and new contexts. As television evolved, mass marketing took another great leap. The advent of cable as an alternative to, and eventually replacement for terrestrial broadcasting, brought out the proliferation of entertainment networks and an explosion of programming content for all ages. More content meant more media consumption, larger audiences, and more advertising revenue. But gradually, these audiences fragmented, giving rise to increasingly sophisticated media and market research and the notion of segmenting an audience, not only by age, gender, and geography, but also by taste, preference, and income. But even as media technology changed, there were a few constants between the 1950s and the 1990s. The telephone was a communication device, the computer was a productivity device, and the television was an entertainment device, all fueled by growing consumer demand and a growing ability for advertising to fund and feed that demand. The rise of the personal computer, the internet, and then the smartphone undermined these constants. Now, all screens increasingly are all things to all people. As a former media and market research executive, I have seen firsthand the transformation of the modern media consumer and the impact of smartphone technology on the ways we engage with media platforms and content. In the not-so-distant past, mass media was a shared, common experience. Organizations sought to reach a large and diverse audience with mass marketing. Today, these same organizations invest in targeted marketing. The goal is to influence the individual consumer's choices through a personalized appeal, not to blanket the airwaves with a single message in the hope that lots of consumers will notice. We can now choose what we watch, where we watch, when we watch, and how we watch in ways unimaginable even a few years ago. And the result of all these choices is a huge increase in time devoted to media. Consider statistics from the Nielsen Company, the world's oldest and largest provider of media viewing and purchasing data, where I served as global chief neuroscientist and executive vice president for several years during a time of tremendous change. Nielsen measures media usage across 10 delivery devices: live TV, streaming programming, AM and FM radio, smartphones, apps and web, personal computers, digital video recorders, DVRs, DVD players, tablets, apps and web, video game consoles, and what are counted as other multimedia tools. Results are presented quarterly in Nielsen's Total Audience Report, where we see that in less than two decades, there has been a massive shift in media consumption time and the types of devices used. According to Nielsen, in 2002, U.S. adults consumed an average of about 48 hours of media per week, mostly via TV, radio, and video cassettes. By 2015, usage had increased to nearly 64 hours per week. By 2016, U.S. adults devoted a staggering 74.5 hours per week, 10 hours and 39 minutes per day, to media consumption across nine different media devices. In 2018, the figure topped 11 hours per day. Americans now spend the equivalent of nearly two full-time jobs consuming media each week. How did Americans manage to find an extra 30-plus hours a week over the last two decades to consume media? The answer? Mobile technologies and the rise of media multitasking. While television continues to dominate viewing behaviors of children and adults, 2011 saw a decline in the amount of live television viewed on average per person per week in the United States. This was the first such decline in the history of Nielsen ratings, which had been measuring viewership since 1950. Even so, overall media consumption increased, with the largest gain coming from the use of portable personal media devices that access content through the internet. Such devices more than made up for the drop in TV viewing, and chief among those personal media devices was the smartphone. The new first screen. Today, we tend to forget the first relatively smartphones with email and internet capabilities, notably the BlackBerry by Research in Motion, which started as a two-way pager in 2002, and the Palm Treo, the first mobile device to send emails and allow users to dial from a list of contacts. But many of us remember the atom-splitting moment that came in 2007 when Apple introduced the pocket-sized iPhone with a sophisticated and intuitive touchscreen, an advanced operating system, and the most impressive software and hardware functionality the world had ever seen. Others followed, including Google with the Android operating system that would compete with Apple's iOS, and Samsung with a suite of phones going toe-to-toe with Apple's hardware. This new generation of smartphones possessed capacities that attracted users everywhere. Most important among these capacities was access to the Internet. Yes, the machines were fashionable and easy to use, integrated valuable technologies like text messaging, and played music on the go. But it was the continuous connection to the Internet and access to the functionality of third-party software applications, that is, apps, that drove the rapid adoption and use of smartphones. The always-on link to the web granted access to this growing universe of software and enabled users to consume any media content that was also online. With these tools, users could also be producers of media content. As new media producers, they too could sell content and valuable real estate to advertisers. But mostly, with smartphones in their pockets, users were easy targets for advertising. As Jack Washlag, a former chief research officer at Turner Broadcasting, puts it, "Smartphone mobility creates new markets of time that extend the places and ability of people to watch video and engage with advertising." All this further drove the rising popularity of smartphones. Sales of the iPhone exploded, and in August 2011, Apple became the most valuable company in the world, topping ExxonMobil. It was a symbolic transfer of power from oil and energy to information technology, from heavy industry to commerce and communications, media, and data. In 2018, Apple broke another record and became the first company to reach a market capitalization of $1 trillion. And between these events, in the summer of 2016, the smartphone quietly reached another important milestone, penetrating over 80% of the mobile phone market, just 1 year prior to the iPhone's 10th anniversary. Indeed, smartphones have set a new standard as the technology with the fastest rate of adoption in the recorded history of humans. Historians of technology look at changes in adoption rates, or penetration, as good indicators of the pace of uptake, allowing them to compare growth rates of vastly different technologies. When thinking about transformative technologies, the move from 40% penetration to 75% penetration is considered an important benchmark. It took electricity and the telephone more than 15 years to go from 40% to 75% penetration in the United States. Personal computers and the Internet took about 10 years. Television was for a long time the champion, clocking in at 5 years. Data from Nielsen and others show that smartphones made the leap from 40% to 75% growth in just 3 years. An astonishing achievement. The mass penetration of the smartphone changed the media market in ways few television executives or major brands could have anticipated. Thus, while growth rates for smartphone sales have slowed as the market becomes saturated, what has not slowed is spending on digital advertising, powered by the endless consumer appetite for new content and apps, and by the simple fact that mobile devices are the best tools with which to engage users. So it was that in 2017, online ad spending surpassed television ad spending for the first time. In the advertising world, mobile devices connected to the Internet are the new first screen, replacing television's decades of dominance. While I believe that connectivity is the key to the success of smartphones, I don't want to discount another monumental feature. Sophisticated smartphone cameras have changed our relationship to photos, videos, and our image of ourselves and others forever. I watched with marked interest how my 2-year-old daughter saw herself on my iPhone, doing something she did a moment ago that was serendipitously captured on video. She halts, smiles inquisitively, and then laughs, shouting, "Daddy, again, again." Wishing to feed her curiosity, I oblige. What is the impact of seeing oneself at such an early age on video or in pictures that are instantly available to ourselves and others? Young people today, with Snapchat filters, pop sockets, and broad social media access, no longer view video in the same way as teenagers of even a few years ago. What does this do to the emerging sense of identity? As Steve Hasker, a former Nielsen executive, puts it, teenagers today are more interested in watching themselves kick a goal than watching soccer star David Beckham kick a goal. It's not just children and teenagers who are changing their behaviors and habits. It's all of us. The average U.S. household now has 25 connected devices, including smartphones, laptops, desktops, streaming devices, smart TVs, gaming systems, fitness trackers, and more. The result is more mobile media consumption, digital communications, and information processing than ever before. The same is true the world over. India, China, and the countries of Africa are becoming mobile-first and mobile-only cultures, as the smartphone becomes the screen of choice over television and personal computers. We are also using our smartphones to access mobile media content in a wide variety of settings that were unimaginable only a few years ago. This gives rise to the other new and consequential behavior I have mentioned, which will be a major theme throughout the book: media and technology multitasking. We can now use media, communications, and information technologies in the store, in the park, in bed, walking down the street, or while sitting in our cars, too often while driving. What was unimaginable a few years ago, today is indispensable. Again, this is not just a U.S. phenomenon. While the United States is a leader when it comes to overall media consumption, the internet and smartphones are propelling similar trends around the world. As overall global use of traditional media like TV, radio, newspapers, and magazines declines, global consumption of media and entertainment increases dramatically through the use of mobile media devices. What drives us to consume so much media? As early media researchers put it in 1973, we use media for many reasons: to match one's wits against others, to get information and advice for daily living, to provide a framework for one's day, to prepare oneself culturally for the demands of upward mobility, or to be reassured about the dignity and usefulness of one's role. In other words, media fulfills multiple perceived personal and social needs. Today, these needs have only multiplied. Now, we use media not only to be informed, entertained, and validated, but also for self-expression, companionship, and emotional stimulation. The uses, gratifications, and rewards that we get from media are more diverse and more emotionally rich than ever. The ability of mobile media, communications, and information technologies to fulfill so many needs and offer so many rewards in so many locations drives new habits around mobile technology that are rapidly changing how we live, love, and labor. Despite the undeniable benefits, these new habits are altering our brains and behaviors in measurable ways, and with unanticipated costs and consequences. Media as a mood regulator. In the fall of 2011, my company, Interscope Research, took on an exciting new project. We were pioneers in the use of neuroscience-inspired technologies to help answer questions about media consumption and marketing in a changing world. We were asked to develop a revelatory study for Time, Inc., publishers of Time and People magazines. Betsy Frank, a Time executive and leader in media research, wanted to understand the rapidly evolving media landscape and get a handle on how different generations of consumers were using new digital devices. To really understand these changes, she needed to employ new research methodologies. Interscope designed a study that would passively monitor media consumption in the lives of two groups, digital natives and digital immigrants. Digital natives were defined as younger adults born after 1990 who grew up in the digital age and never knew a world without the internet. They were perceived as being more interested in digital media platforms connected to the internet and less interested in traditional media, that is, media without a connection to the internet. Digital immigrants were born before 1990, perhaps, like me, well before. They recalled the days of traditional media's dominance, before the internet existed or was widely available. Digital immigrants had to adjust to the digital age. The research participants were all in the Boston area. They all owned a smartphone and an iPad and were paid to live their lives as usual, except that they would be wearing special point-of-view glasses with cameras that recorded every movement of the 1.5-day testing period. And they would wear a biometric belt to measure their physiological responses to their environment. It was a challenging and technical study. After we completed the fieldwork, we moved to the daunting task of coding and analyzing over 300 hours of unique data from this first-of-its-kind study. We called it a biometric day in the life. The results changed the way I think about the relationship between emerging media habits and their impact on our behaviors and our brains. In terms of time spent with media, consistent with national statistics, we found that both digital natives and digital immigrants consumed a lot. On average, participants spent 2/3 of their non-working hours consuming media of some sort. And while both groups consumed about the same number of hours of media throughout the day, true to their moniker, digital natives spent a disproportionate amount of their time on digital devices, while digital immigrants spent more time with newspapers, magazines, radio, and television. This was not surprising. What was surprising was the way participants paid attention to media. During the analyses, we noticed something peculiar in their media behaviors. Participants in both groups switched their attention among media platforms with surprising frequency. While rapid switching between media devices was common to both groups, I wondered if it was more prevalent among digital natives. In other words, was there a difference in media attention span, a term we coined, between the two groups? We realized we were witnessing the evolution of media multitasking from a unique perspective. And what we found generated headlines. The older digital immigrants switched media devices an average of 17 times per hour, translating to an average media attention span of about 3.5 minutes. In comparison, the younger digital natives switched media devices on average 27 times per hour, averaging nearly every 2.25 minutes. This is an astonishing 60% increase in the rate of switching, making for a huge drop in the media attention span across a single generation. The biometric portion of the study was equally fascinating. We used biometric devices that capture real-time, moment-by-moment changes in the participants' heart rate and skin conductivity, two physiologic indicators of emotional intensity. We also time-locked the biometric data to the video from the cameras in their glasses. This allowed us to analyze how users' emotional responses fluctuated as they consumed different types of media throughout the day. As expected, we found that, on average, digital natives were more emotionally engaged with digital media platforms, and digital immigrants were more emotionally engaged with traditional media platforms. This is not surprising, given that digital natives spent more time using digital platforms. Our emotions drive our behaviors. What was surprising was that both digital natives and digital immigrants experienced a greater range of emotional responses when using a single platform for sustained periods than when media multitasking. This suggests that when we are focused on a single platform, our emotional response is more dynamic. The highs are higher and the lows are lower. In contrast, media multitasking constrains both the highs and the lows, but the average emotional response is more intense. The result is a flatter but more consistently elevated emotional response. This got us thinking. What drives consumers to switch media platforms so frequently when doing so results in blunted emotional peaks? What is it about media multitasking that the brain finds rewarding? The answer was suggested in the data, but emerged more clearly after several other studies in the more controlled environment of our lab. We found that people switch from one media experience to another when their emotional response begins to drop in intensity, suggesting lower levels of arousal. In other words, we found that media consumers switch media platforms when they are bored. What we have come to learn is that our mobile devices provide so many opportunities for rewards, so many motivations to engage, that they are inexhaustible vehicles of emotional arousal. The more frequently we switch to our smartphone or tablet, the less likely our emotional intensity falls, and the faster we recover states of higher emotional arousal. This helps explain why, in study after study, we saw that the use of smartphones and media multitasking during traditional television viewing goes up significantly during commercial breaks. We tune into television for programming that is relevant and engaging, whereas advertising sometimes engages us, but often is just boring. Thanks to our digital devices, we need not tolerate the low arousal of boredom. We have all had the experience of reaching for our smartphones when we are just a little bit bored, standing in line at the store, in an elevator, on the bus, or in the car. The more often we switch to a new and more stimulating task, the more often the brain feels rewarded. But there is a downside. In fact, we are chasing our own tails. As a result of staving off boredom with digital devices, we become less tolerant of dull tasks and therefore get bored more easily. It is a vicious cycle. We have learned to manage boredom and other uncomfortable feelings by using mobile media, communications, and information technology as a type of mood regulator, even though, as we will hear, these tools contribute to negative moods. Good news and bad news. The Time Inc. study generated amazing insights into the drivers of media multitasking. At least in some cases, we are motivated as much by the potential pleasure and reward of emotional engagement as by the escape of low emotional arousal and boredom. But the study left open important questions about shrinking media attention spans across generations. Are the brains of digital natives actually wired differently, thanks to the media they consume and the technology they use? Is differential attention span a product of different brains, brains changed by the world around us? Or are the divergences in media attention spans merely the result of preferences or physiological changes that track with age? In other words, if we repeated the study a few years later, would we see that the digital natives maintain their shorter attention spans even as they age, signifying a group effect? Or would we see that younger people have shorter attention spans, but as they get older, their focus improves as their brains mature, indicating an age effect? A group effect, also called a cohort effect, would mean that digital natives have shorter attention spans by virtue of some characteristics common to their group, characteristics that don't go away as they age, such as exposure to digital devices. An age effect would mean that there is no generational effect, that there is no specific brain differences between digital natives and digital immigrants. In late 2016, almost exactly 5 years after the original study, Interscope was acquired by the Nielsen Company. With access to more data and more resources, we had an opportunity to replicate the research with a larger sample. We found evidence for both the generational group effect and the age effect. Media attention span is a function both of growing up wired and of getting older. We interpreted the new results to be good news and bad news. First, the good news. 5 years after the original study, with a new sample of both groups of participants in very similar study conditions, Media attention spans showed the same trends as in the original 2011 study. Older participants, on average, demonstrated a longer media attention span. This suggests that as our brains mature with age, we can focus longer. The bad news? In the new study, the oldest population showed a slight decrease in their attention spans compared to the oldest population in the earlier study. In addition, the difference in media attention spans between the older and younger groups in the new study was less than it had been in the original study, despite the fact that the age difference in the second study was greater. These are only two relatively small studies, so we must be careful not to weigh too heavily the findings. But they should still give us pause. The results suggest that as media technologies continue to penetrate our lives and media multitasking becomes more pervasive, there is a trend toward less tolerance for boredom and shrinking attention spans across all age groups. It appears that we are all being rewired to some degree. It is also concerning that the media attention spans in both studies were remarkably short. The average media attention span we found across both studies was under 3 minutes. We can be confident that this is short because we can compare our results to studies of similar tasks. This is important when evaluating attention spans. The researcher must carefully consider the task in question because different tasks can be expected to command different amounts of attention. Whether we are studying for an exam, writing a report for work, paying our bills, or playing video games, measured attention spans vary greatly by task. In this case, the task is engaging with one media platform or device while another media platform or device is nearby. Because media multitasking is a relatively new behavior and the research to capture it is expensive, it is hard to find comparisons to put our results into context. But research from 2008 offers a relevant benchmark. That study investigated the impact of background television on children's play and measured the media attention spans of 1-year-old and 3-year-old children as they played with toys while the television was on near them. Although this clearly is not exactly equivalent to the studies I undertook with Interscope and Nielsen, the methods used to calculate media attention spans were very similar. The 2008 study found that 3-year-old children had an average attention span of 1.8 minutes. When we compare this to our own results, we see that the digital native's attention span is only 22% higher than that of a 3-year-old, while the digital immigrant's attention span is 56% higher. This suggests that, roughly speaking, today's young adults have media attention spans significantly closer to those of 3-year-olds than to those of adults. While not a perfect comparison, more research is certainly needed. The results suggest that the proliferation of media devices has increased media multitasking to such a degree that our collective media attention spans appear to make little progress well into adulthood. What is the impact of shorter attention spans? Our 2011 Time study included an online survey of 1,700 adults nationwide, which found that digital natives reported that they were more easily bored, more easily distracted, and were more likely to get nervous compared with digital immigrants. We cannot know for sure all the reasons for these gaps, but the survey also found that digital natives were significantly more likely than digital immigrants to carry their smartphone from room to room, to report that their smartphone was the first thing they used if they woke up in the middle of the night, and to indicate that they prefer texting to talking to people. This connection between emotional distress and dependence on digital tools was strengthened by a 2018 study in which U.S. teens reported they would feel bored and anxious to a moderate or great extent if they had to go without their smartphones for a day. These results foreshadow some of the mental health consequences of frequently using media as a mood regulator. In the concluding section of our Time paper, we called for more sophisticated research methods and models, informed by more sophisticated brain and behavioral science, to stay abreast of how and why media is increasingly consumed at such high rates across platforms, cultures, and generations. Since then, researchers in diverse disciplines have been inspired by changes in media habits to learn more about how the brain itself is changing in response to these behavioral changes. The result is the beginning of a neuroscience-informed model of engagement that shows how new media, communications, and information technologies are altering us at a physiological level. We are just beginning to understand the consequences of the massive shifts in media habits and consumption patterns that have occurred since the introduction of smartphones into our lives. But one thing is clear: change is the new constant. And thanks to lifelong neuroplasticity, our brains keep changing in response to new media and technologies, regardless of our age. The precise reasons that our brains are so responsive to media stimuli are not always easy to describe. We know the answers to some of the underlying questions. In other cases, we are left to speculate on the basis of available information. To the extent that there are answers to why our brains engage with smartphones and related technology in the ways they do, some of the answers are informed by a trip back in time. It is not enough to pay a visit to 2011 or the iPhone rollout or the birth of the internet.
We have to look to the. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.